He's with me. We live together. We remember.
Shorts, the bolo shirts, and guys, those New Balances.
I'm
It's easy as the fastest thing.
Well,
it's not always the best thing.
You need to go schedule like it drops. The dogs get different.
Come on, you can try grab it.
And once they get there, I'm up.
Brothers and sisters.
Some of the time, like, so they.
How many did she have?
She's still.
Did you ever meet them all, or were they all?
And of course, that means I eat the one except the whole.
Two sets of twins.
Oh.
One set died at birth.
And they don't mean that, they just get back.
Can't remember.
I told them, I just don't.
And Betty's dad.
They take it, so he gave me a hug before, he just take it. Two weeks after I take it, I broke out some itches.
Cousin Sydney's dad.
And then after it got out of the system, I grew.
We'll have to tell them where it's at. I can read lips usually, but I am having a hard time.
It changes the voice and gets worse and worse.
Well, that's.
That's what I'm trying to say now. I'll tell you what I think he said, and then you can correct me.
Cousin Sydney's dad was.
They told me about that.
And Betty's dad.
Anything that could have looked like a whole person.
Yeah. wife. She'll be led by a little child, and I shall be changed, changed from the old creature that I am. Oh, I'd like to thank the family for asking me to be here this morning. A lot of men don't find it to be a privilege to preach a funeral. I'm a little different. I'd rather preach a funeral than a wedding. People stay dead, they don't stay married. So I don't like weddings. This morning, listening to that song, talk about peace in the Bible. The Bible says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. I've known Miss Haynes ever since I was a kid. My mama and her were buddies. She used to go to my mother's house and visit. Mom used to bake a lot. She'd give her baked goods to take home with her. And I've had the privilege of knowing Delinda. The rest of the family I don't know. You're probably wondering what I'm doing here. Some years ago, Sister Delinda gave her heart to the Lord. And she come up to me at service one night. She says, do I need to be baptized? I said, well, it's part of God's great commission is to be baptized. She said, will you baptize him? And I said, well, it's flooding. She says, I don't care. I want to be baptized. So I took her down to the creek, and we crossed over a flood barrier and carried her out there and baptized her. And this morning I woke up. Both ends of my driveway is flooded out. Bridge is washed out right below the house. I called the funeral home and said, there's no way I could make it. And right away they started trying to find somebody to fill in and couldn't find nobody. And I finally made it out. Delinda made the statement when I got here. She says, I knew there wasn't no flood gonna hold you back. I find it an honor to be able to stand here before you this morning and preach this sweet lady's funeral. I know, like I said, I've known Nelda Haynes since I was a youngin. And I'm just glad she's at peace. She ain't suffering. She ain't suffering. That's the thing we need to realize this morning. That she is not suffering. The Bible says that she is but asleep. And she shall sleep until the trump of God calls. And then the Bible says the dead in Christ shall rise, and we which remain shall be caught up together with her and the other saints that have gone on to meet him in the air, and then the judgment. And this morning, I want you to know I'm not here to judge her. It's not my place. It's not my place to judge you. The scripture also says, judge not, that you be not judged. So it's not my place. I'm not to judge this morning. My place this morning is to try to give you peace and hope and let you know I'm here for you today and I'm going to be praying for you. Could we just bow our heads right now and just ask the Lord in this place. Father, we come before you this morning. Lord, we ask you, God, that you would come into this house this morning, God, that you would comfort this family. Lord, I pray, God, that you would put your arms around them. Dry their tears, God. Let them have tears of joy and happiness this morning, knowing that Mama's not suffering, God, and that you are a sovereign God, and that you love us. Lord, I pray, God, that you'd help me to do what's right this morning. Lord, we ask it in your name, Jesus. I've been asked to sing. If you don't like it, blame the one that asked. I can't sing like I used to. I'm an old man now. Thank you. not prove His love for me. And the anchor holds the ship. I'd like to read to you a scripture in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, and in verse 44 it says, "Now as the natural body is raised unto a spiritual body, there is no natural body, there is no spiritual body. And it is written, the first man, Adam, was made a living soul, and the second man, Adam, a quickening spirit. Howbeit was the first, which was spiritual, but the second, natural, and nevertheless, the spiritual." And the scripture says in verse 55, it says, "O death, where is thy sting? Grave, where is thy victory?" You know, us that are alive got this all wrong. We got it all looking like death is such a horrible thing. And it's not. If you're a child of God, there's no sting of death. It's just, it's to me, it'll be an easy way out of here. You know, Nelda, I've known her for years, and she suffered in her body. She's had pain. She's seen things that the rest of us has never thought of. So today, Nelda is at peace. She don't have to worry about her grandchildren. She don't have to worry about her children. She doesn't have to suffer with the pain in her body no more. And that's something we all need to realize, that she's at peace this morning. Oh, yeah, you're going to miss her. I buried my mama six years ago. I buried my daughter 15 years ago. I know what death's all about. Buried my father. I know what it's about. I know the pain of losing. But I also know that in the resurrection, there's going to be a great reunion. I'm going to tell you right now, if you're living right, and you're doing what's according to what the Word of God says, you're going to get to see her again. And we're going to get to spend eternity with Jesus Christ. If we're doing what we know to do that's right. Now listen, I'm telling you this morning, I can't judge her. It's not my place. I can't judge you, but all I can do is sound a warning to you. Times is getting worse. The scripture says, such as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the time of the coming of the Lord. What's going on today? I just heard this morning about two little boys over in Waverly. Their mama had them on a roof. They were autistic. They fell off in the creek, and they can't find them. We're living in horrible, horrible times. And we know that the Lord is just before coming back to receive His own unto Him. So this morning, I know that she would want me to tell you, prepare yourself. for just that thing. Now, you may never hear me or see me again, and you may never get the opportunity again to hear what I'm saying to you this morning, but this is my job. My job is to warn you that time is short. I guarantee you that when she passed, she didn't know that that day was going to be her last day of breath. She didn't know it. My 15-year-old daughter, when she got killed in that automobile accident, she didn't know that morning when she called me on the phone and said, "Dad, I'm on my way home." She didn't know she wasn't going to make it home. Death is inevitable. The Bible says it is appointed unto man to die. It's an appointment. Every man, woman, child is going to face that appointment. You can't call him on the phone and say, "Look, I don't want to go today." It ain't your doctor. You can't call and change your appointment. The moment you were born, the clock was set above your life, and that's how long you're going to live. Now, you may not like me after today, but I've got to do this. She'd want me to. She'd want me to warn you that the time that we have is shorter than it was when Jesus Christ walked on the earth. A lot of people are sitting back and saying, "Well, I heard that before, and I heard that before," but how much closer is it from the time you heard it before? And it's my job. And that's what she'd want me to do. It's my job this morning. I loved her. She was a good woman. Oh, y'all might not agree with some of her ways, but I'm going to tell you what. She was a good woman. She spoke her mind.
Amen.
She spoke her mind. If she didn't like you, she'd let you know she didn't like you. Y'all didn't know I knew Nelda Haynes, did you? But I know her. I knew how she was. I've heard her tell people what she thought. You know what? I'm just going to be honest with you this morning. Is it okay if I be honest with you this morning? That's probably why there ain't a lot of people here this morning. It's because Nelda didn't have a whole lot of freedom. She chose who she wanted to be her friend. She did, and it was her family. She loved her family. She loved her family. She would tell me every time I'd see her, she'd say, "Preacher, are you praying for my youngins?" I said, "Nelda, I'm praying for you, honey." I'd just be honest with her. "Nelda, I'm praying for you, honey." She said, "All right, you pray for my youngins." That was her wish. That was her wish. She would love to know that her children are walking on the right side. When my father died, I wasn't serving God. I was pretty wild. But my mama got to see me preach. Matter of fact, she was one of the people in my church when I become a pastor. She followed me to the church and said under me, I asked her one time, I said, "Mama, did you ever think that I'd be your pastor?" She said, "Boy, I never figured you'd get saved." Because I was pretty rough. I was the meanest kid she had. I ain't ashamed to tell it, I was. But God changed me. And my mama got to see it. And I remember when my mother died, I went to the graveyard one evening, and I talked to the Lord. And I told the Lord, I said, "Lord God, Mama seen me change. She seen it. Would you tell my daddy that I'm changed? I'm not the man I used to be." She would love to know this morning that her kids is walking in grace, that her grandchildren are walking in grace, and that when your number comes up, when your time is called, you'll make it home to be with her. Now, I know this probably ain't nothing like you've ever heard at no funeral, but I'm going to tell you, I don't do one different than I do the others. I preach this way every funeral I preach. I try to warn the people. I can't warn Nelda. It's over. She had her opportunity to make it right with God. And from what I've been told, she made that opportunity. She took that opportunity. She run with it. And now it's your turn. If you ever want to see her in peace. Because there is coming a day that the grave's gonna bust open. And the dead in Christ are gonna rise. And we which remain shall be changed in a moment, in the twinkle of an eye. And be called up with them in the air. The Bible says that right here in 1 Corinthians. This says that. We're all gonna be called up to be judged for the deeds done in our mortal bodies. All of us. And I know some of you younger guys got that cocky attitude, meaner than the devil. God can't change me. You can't be no worse than I was. I guarantee you. I was the worst of the worst. I'm telling you right now, God can change you. If he can change me, he can change you. If God can save me, and I know in my heart today, I know if my time comes up, if my number is called, I know where I'm going. Don't weep for me, don't mourn for me, because I'm going to be with my Father. And I'm talking about Jesus Christ the righteous. Are you ready? If he calls you this morning, I'm going to tell you what you need to do, church. Find you a church. Get in it. And start living for God. Start helping that preacher, helping that church. There's a place right now that's waiting for you. I guarantee you. It may not be the one with the stained glass windows. But there's a church out there somewhere that will accept you in and help you. I guarantee you. If they won't come see me, I'll pastor a church. I'll take you. They don't make them too bad for me. But you need God. You need God. I'm gonna tell you right down, and I'm sorry if I'm hurting your feelings, but the only way you're gonna make it through this is you're gonna have to get God to help you. The Bible says that before Jesus died, he told his disciples, he says, I'm gonna go away, but my Father is going to send a comforter to comfort you in all things. That's the Holy Spirit. It's the Spirit of God. It's the Spirit of Christ that's going to come back and it's going to comfort you in this time. And I truly believe that. I truly believe that. Like I said, I'm not no stranger to death. I buried sisters and brothers, my mom, my dad, my daughter. I preached no telling how many funerals. Young, old, there's no respecter of death. Death don't care how old you are or how young you are, it's coming. But you need to be ready. Well, this ain't something like a funeral you ever been to, is it? But this is my job, is to try to warn you. You're alive. And one day you'll meet death. It's standing right now knocking on your door, and you don't even know it. If she was here, she'd tell you what I'm telling you. Get ready. I hope I ain't said nothing to make you dislike me. Or call the Pope and tell him what I did. It don't matter. I ain't hooked up with him at all.
Amen.
But I'm going to tell you right now, if you need me, that young lady's got my phone number. If she don't, this funeral home's got my phone number. You call me. Now, if you're mad at me, you're going to call me and cuss me out. Don't call me. Tell Glenda she's the one that asked me to come do this. Or tell me after service. You didn't appreciate what I said. I got big shoulders. I'll take it. And I'll pray. And I'll ask you to forgive me if I have. But this morning, I want you to understand something. I'm not sorry for telling you you need God. There ain't a man, there ain't a woman, there ain't a child sitting inside this building this morning that don't need God. Not one of us. That includes me. I've got to have him. Every day of my life, I've got to have him. I don't know tomorrow if one of my boys won't die. Or my wife. And I've got to have God to help me make it through that. You don't know tomorrow who's next. And you're going to have God to help you through it. I guarantee it. I couldn't have done it. Listen, when I lost my 15-year-old daughter in that car wreck, I just talked to her on the phone, not 15 minutes before she got killed. And if I hadn't had God in my life, there ain't no telling what I'd have done. Ain't no telling how my life would have turned out. But God comforted me, kept me, and held on to me, and carried me through it. And he will you, if you'll ask him. Let's everybody bow our heads. Close your eyes. I want to pray for you. Dear gracious Heavenly Father, I do love you. Lord, I thank you for the opportunity to stand here before this family. Lord, I pray, God, that you would ease their hearts, God. I pray, God, that to comfort them, let it come into this room. Let them feel your Shekinah glory, God, as you wrap your arms around them to comfort them in this time of need. Lord, I pray, God, that you would help them to realize that they need you, Father. And Lord, help me to do what's right. Help me to be the man that you want me to be, God. And Lord, I'll forever give you the praise, the glory, and the honor. For it's all due in your name, Jesus. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Don't be afraid.
I'm still as cute as ever.
Cute. Yeah. Oh, man.